Yo, peace was good. Works in the installment of introduction. The album, the artist that I'll be talking about today is Jay-Z. You guys should know who Jay-Z is. Jay-Z is an entrepreneur, dubbed one of the best MCs of all time, the GOAT, businessman, all that stuff. Like, great businessman, you know, all that stuff, right? My introduction. Well, before I start, I want to give you guys a brief description of what introduction is, because some people might not know what introduction, the whole storming of introduction is. It's pretty much where I talk about an artist that I got introduced to and how I got introduced to them, and then when I do the brief description of how I got introduced to that artist, then I kind of go through, throughout the whole albums and stuff like that, the albums that they put out and stuff like that, even if it was like collaboration albums they did with certain artists, and I do talk about them. So and that's pretty much introduction. So I hope you guys got the gist of that. Now back to the video. My introduction to Jay-Z had to be like around, I want to say like the late 90s. It was the late 90s. It had to be either 98 or 99. It was like in the summer of one of those years. And I remember hearing the song that comes to my head, the first song I've heard from Jay-Z was actually Hard Knock Life. And it was the summer of 99, because I think Hard Knock Life came out like around like late 98, something like that. So it had to be like 99 is when I first heard Jay-Z, and it was Hard Knock Life. And I fucking love that song. I mean, with the Annie sample and stuff, like, it was very catchy. And I was 11 years old at the time, so it was like, it was dope. But it was very relevant because it talks about niggas living in the hood. Like, yo, it was hard in the streets, you know what I mean? And it was very relatable. So that song definitely spoke volumes to me and stuff like that. And that year, I graduated from my elementary school, 6th grade, then I'm going to 7th grade. And in 7th grade, around that time was when Jay-Z dropped Volume 3. And then you had songs like Do It Again, Snoopy Track, and, you know, Big Pimpin', and, you know, songs like that. Those were the songs back in 99 what was popping in from Jay-Z. And from then on, like, because around that time, like, around 99, you know, that's when, like, Rough Riders was running shit, Rockefeller, then you had Cash Money. Cash Money in the South was running things, and then you had No Limit and stuff like that. So that was that era. And then around that time, for me, hip-hop was not in a good place. Like, I wasn't feeling none of that shit when it first came out. You know, I was all about, like, in fact, in the late 90s, I wasn't even listening to hip-hop like that. I was mostly listening to, like, you know, 80s music and stuff like that. So that was my thing, because in the 90s I was all about the 80s, but it seemed like when I got older it was all about the 90s, and, you know, whatever the case may be. And so 99, you know, like I said, Volume 3 came out and stuff like that. Obviously I didn't hear the albums yet, you know, I didn't hear those albums yet, which I'll talk about them briefly and stuff like that. And fast forward to, I want to say 2000 was when the Dynasty came out. Dynasty, Rockefeller Dynasty came out. And the first Jay-Z album I copped was actually the Dynasty album. But I actually got that back in 2000. I think, was it 2000? I want to say it was 2000 or 2001. Like, early 2001, because my birthday's in January and shit. And I think I got that for my birthday. Of that, 2001 or some shit like that. I don't remember. No, it was in 2000 when I got Dynasty, because I remember I got Nas I Am and stuff like that around that same time. So Dynasty was actually the first Jay-Z album that I ever copped. And I love that album. And back in 2001, when I was in high school, is when I copped Reasonable Doubt, all right? And when I first heard Reasonable Doubt, it just took me to a whole different world. I was like, wow, like, damn, Jay-Z with this album right here. I mean, listen to this shit. Is this song Regress that's playing in the background? I mean, that shit right there is just so magical. Like, just like the wordplay, the beat choices that he had at that time, it was just so fucking ill. I mean, I love the album so much. Back in 2006, was the 10-year anniversary of of Reasonable Doubt, and Double XL actually did a great fucking article on Reasonable Doubt, and I have it right here. I was in New York at the time. I was visiting New York and stuff like that. I was staying in Queens and Brooklyn and stuff like that, and I was in the city with my boys and shit, you know, just walking around Manhattan and stuff like that. Went to one of the newsstands, and, you know, I copped this shit. I think it was in Harlem. I was in Harlem, and I copped this shit right here. And it actually talks about each track very descriptively. I mean, it's just so ill. Like, I'll give you an example. Like, it talks about how in Coming of Age, originally, it wasn't Memphis Bleek on the song. It was actually Shaheem. Like, Shaheem was supposed to be on the track instead of Memphis Bleek. But I think at that time, Shaheem was working on his second album. I want to say the Lost Generation album. Shaheem definitely keep your head up, serving time, like doing like 14 years of manslaughter or whatever. But he was working on that album and stuff like that. Sorry about that, that's my phone. And so he didn't make the cut. So I think Memphis Bleek, you know, he was kind of like pestering Jay-Z, kind of bothering him, kind of messing with him. So Jay-Z kind of gave in and let him shine on the track, and then the rest is history. Things like that. And then, like, they talk about the song Feeling It, where Feeling It was originally a Camp Low song. You could tell when you listen to it. You know, stuff like that that I didn't know at the time. I thought that was pretty cool. And it actually talks about this right here. So, obviously, you're not going to find this because it's long out of print. But if you go on eBay, I'm pretty sure you can find this on eBay and stuff like that. So, right there, Reasonable Doubt. Definitely a classic album, in my opinion. And then, this is where now I go through all the albums and I talk about the descriptive, like how I get into this, some of the albums, my thoughts on the albums and stuff like that. So that was it with Reasonable Doubt. Now I'm going to talk about In My Lifetime Volume 1 that came out a year later. When that album came out in 97, when I heard it, it was a complete 180 compared to Reasonable Doubt. Because you got to remember, this is 97, so around that time, you know, Biggie had died. He had just put out Life After Death, which, you know, I thought it was an okay album. I'll get into that some other time. Kind of overrated, if you ask me, but that's just my opinion. You know, because of that album, a lot of artists, especially in the East Coast, try to follow that same route as Life After Death, but it didn't really work with them. And that was the case with Jay-Z with In My Lifetime Volume 1. But he had songs like You Are My Sunshine and, oh my god, I fucking hate that song. Even to this day, like, I tried listening to some of those songs, like, I couldn't get into that shit. Like, you know, yeah, songs like The City Is Mine, You'll Always Be My Sunshine, and oh my god, like, that song, oh, like, I cannot listen to that shit at all. But it has some dope joints. You had songs like Streets Is Watching, Face Off with Sauce Money, A Million and One Questions, The Rap Game, Crack Game, Friend of Foe Part 2. I mean, oh my god, like, that song, like, this shit right here, that's off the In My Lifetime Volume 1. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, Who You With, you know, shit like that. Actually, it's called Friend of Foe 98, excuse me, not Part 2, but it might as well be Part 2. But, you know, shit like that, man. I mean, my thing with that album, I kind of feel like Jay-Z with that album, he fell victim to the bad boy syndrome. And what I mean by that is, like, where, you know, Puffy, you know, he kind of had, like, where the artist had, like, some street tracks, but then he had mostly filler tracks, like, radio-friendly tracks. And that was the case with In My Lifetime Volume 1. And if I'm not mistaken, Puffy actually executive produced the album In My Lifetime Volume 1. You can tell just some of the production and stuff like that. You can tell with songs like Sunshine and The City Is Mine and shit like that. So, but yeah, that album, it was okay. You know, it could have been better, but it definitely had some dope joints. And where I'm from and stuff like that, that's a classic hip-hop track. I don't care, nobody says. Then you got Volume 2, Hard Knock Life. Oh my God, that it to me is one of my favorite Jay-Z albums of all time, besides Reasonable Doubt. It's actually I want to say it's like my second favorite Jay-Z album. I mean, you got songs like, you know, Can I Get a What? Money Cash Hoes. Money Cash Hoes, Originators 98 with him and Jazzo. Nigga What, Nigga Who, all that. Oh my God, like that album, Reservoir Dogs and LOX. Oh my, a week ago, It's All Right with Memphis Bleak. Yo, like that album is so ill, and mad people hate on that album. I don't understand that. And if I'm not mistaken, Volume 2 is actually his best selling album. It's like his highest selling album to date. And you can see why if you listen to the album. It's just so well. I have to do a review on these albums, so definitely stay tuned for that. And that's it for Volume 2. Then Volume 3, which came out like in late 99. Excuse me, get some water. Excuse me. Then you got Volume 3, Lifetime of Sean Carter. You know, you had songs like Big Pimpin', Do It Again with Beanie, Snoopy track with Juvenile. Snoopy track was like an unofficial single. Like, it wasn't an official single, but Hot 97 would play it like in the radio and stuff like that. It might as well have been a single, but you know how that go. That's one thing I miss about Hot 97 is the fact like they would play certain songs that weren't singles, but they would play it as a single. And I miss those days of Hot 97. They would do shit like that. So, you know, with that album, when I finally listened to that album, it was an okay album, but I felt like the album was a little bit all over the place. You know what I mean? It was a little bit kind of like Volume 1, but it was, I don't know, it was like all over the place, you know what I mean? I feel like it wasn't like his best work, in my opinion. But it did have some dope joints like Dope Man, Snoopy Track, So Ghetto, one of Primo's illest beats. There's just so much ill joints on that joint right there. But like I said, it's not his best joint right there. And then we get to The Dynasty, Rock My Familia. There's been some confusion with that album because originally Rock My Familia was actually supposed to be a compilation album, but it's not. It just ended up becoming his album and stuff like that. And that album to me is a very important album in Jay-Z's career, because you know, with that album, it actually introduced like some artists. It introduced some artists, you know what I mean? It introduced, you know, Freeway for the first time. It introduced Just Blaze, people like that. And I think a lot of people don't really realize that, but that was pretty much like the first time you heard even though Just Blaze has been around since the late 90s, like he's done stuff like Buckshot and stuff like that, but he wasn't really known like that. He's done stuff for Killer Priest's his View From A Side album, which was fucking horrible. I did a review on, definitely check that out. Just go on my channel, type in Killer Priest, whatever, View From A Side. But anyways, it was that album when, you know, pretty much, you know, Just Blaze got his break. You know, it's kind of what brought him out to the world and stuff like that. And yeah, man. And he had dope songs like Parking Lot Pimpin'. That I just wanna hustle, bit. Like, I just wanna love you. That shit, it was cool, but after a while, it got really fucking annoying. Like, I've heard it so many times, like I got so tired of it. But then you had songs like Streets Is Talking. Then you have songs like Squeeze First, Where You Been with Beanie Siegel. Oh my God, that song right there is so ill. Where, you know, Beanie Siegel's talking about how about his pops and stuff like that. How his pops wasn't there for him, like fuck you and all that shit. It was a very heartfelt song right there. That song could have been on Beanie Siegel's first album. Like that's how, cause he pretty much took up the whole song. I think Jay-Z only had like one verse off the album, of that song or whatever, and stuff like that. You know, just so much, You, Me, and Her, that's another song that was actually a song that Hot 97 played as a single. It wasn't a single, but Hot 97 played that song as a single. Like, it was so popular. And so, with You, Me, and Her, I mean, Dynasty, definitely a classic album. And then we got Blueprint. To me, the last good Jay-Z album, in my opinion. I know I'm going to get a lot of shit for that, but to me, that was Jay-Z's comeback album, in my opinion, because, you know, coming from Volume 3, it was kind of like, kind of iffy, and then around that time, he was kind of going through that whole thing with the Lance Hunch Rivera stabbing and stuff like we stabbed on and stuff like that, so it was a lot going on around that time. But then when he came on Blueprint, oh my god, like that album, classic. At that time, obviously, he was going through the beef with, you know, Nas and, you know, whole QB. Predominantly, you know, Mobb Deep and, well, realistically, Prodigy and Nas. Those are the only two that he had beef with and stuff like that. And so, you know, he had songs like Takeover. But he pretty much annihilated Prodigy. I love Prodigy, but Prodigy did not come back from that. You know what I mean? I don't care what nobody says. I mean, he killed a certain part of Prodigy that Prodigy, for some reason, just never got back. And I explained that in a Mobb Deep introduction video. Definitely check that out. And then, you know, you have songs like Ain't No Love, The Rule Is Back. I mean, oh my god, like that. Breathe Easy, Lyrical Exercise, Renegade. Yeah, that album, certified classic right there, all right? Then a year later in 2002, he came out with Blueprint 2, The Gift and the Curse. That was a double disc album. And by that time, that's when you started noticing kind of like the collaborations he did with Beyonce. So you could kind of tell, like, they kind of had something going on. It was like very early on, but people didn't really catch it, you know what I mean? But right there, you could tell that, like, the chemistry between them two were good and stuff like that. He had songs like Meet the Parents, You Don't Know, the remix with M.O.P., a couple other songs. That album I did not like at all. I did not like that album. Way too many filler tracks, in my opinion. To me, it was all over the place with a lot of too many radio-friendly songs. It had some decent street tracks, but it was overbound with filler tracks and stuff like that. I didn't really care for that album too much. And that same year, he came out with The Best of Both Worlds. You know, he had the song The Fiesta joint and stuff like that. I'm not gonna front, that was a dope song, but I didn't even really bother listening to the album because at that time I wasn't really a big R. Kelly fan. You know, I just didn't like some of the stuff that R. Kelly was putting out at that time. But then looking back to it, I do like it now, but I was too young to appreciate it. I'm more of a, you know, 12 play, you know, Public Announcement. Is it Public Announcement? His old group, Public Announcement. Like that era, born in the 90s, R. Kelly. You know, the self-titled album, you know, in the R album, you know, that shit, that's an R. Kelly I like, you know what I mean? But I didn't even bother checking out Best of Both Worlds, so I can't even tell you much of that album, but it's crazy because they weren't even in the studio when they recorded the album, so that right there tells you something. And then in 2003, we got the infamous Black Album. Oh my god. Hold on, let me see how much time I got left. Alright, I gotta wrap it up. Then we got the Black Album. One of the worst albums he put out, in my opinion. I don't care what nobody says. I get a lot of shit for that. I know I'm gonna get a lot of shit for that. I don't give a fuck. I feel like it's one of his most overrated albums in his discography, you know, because at this time, this is when, you know, he was about to retire, and I'm thinking, oh shit, he's about to retire, so I'm thinking, when you're about to retire, yo, you're gonna come out with a bang. Because you gotta understand, when people say they're about to retire, they're about to break up, you know, you got, you know, artists like EPMD, when they came out with Business Never Personal in back in 92, that was the last time they put out an album until like 97. But when they came out with that album, that shit has some bangers. Like, it's actually my favorite EPMD album as well as Business As Usual. Like, they went out with a bang. That's what I... Same thing with Boogie Down Production with Sex and Violence. They went... Well, realistically, it's just KRS-One. Went out with a fucking bang. Not the case with Black Album. It just... To me, it felt like leftover tracks from, like, Blueprint 2, in my opinion. It's just... I don't know, man. Well, not leftover tracks, but it's just, I don't know, man. It just didn't feel, it didn't feel inspired. It felt uninspiring to me, like, listening to it. Like, I didn't, it felt all over the place, you know what I mean? Like, yes, I've seen the Fade to Black documentary. That was pretty cool. But it was to me, it was all over the place. And you had songs, like, you had the song Threat. That was pretty cool. That was my introduction to Ninth Wonder. Then you had songs like, Encore, which to me it reminded me of fucking like something you hear like on Price Is Right. Like, it had the da 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 da, like that bull. Like, no, like I couldn't even listen to that shit. Then you got songs like Allure, Justify My Thug, and I'm good. Then you got The Dirt Off Your Shoulder, that was cool. Then, the PSA joint, that was pretty cool. But I got tired of that song so much because that's all you heard, like, around that. Even to this day, when you go to clubs, they play that song. Like, I can't even stand listening to that song. I could have done without that song. Without that song or the album, not for me. Then we got Kingdom Come, that came out 3 years later. That album felt very rushed. Again, another album that felt very uninspiring. It was just all over the place. It felt rushed. You could listen to it, you could tell. I just wasn't crazy about it. It had some decent joints. It had some songs, what's the songs? It had Oh My God, Kingdom Come, Show Me What You Got. I liked that. That was pretty cool. Minority Report, that was pretty cool. But then you had songs like Beach Chairs, Lost Ones. I wasn't crazy about that song. But then you had the next year in 07, they have America's Nightmare, American Gangster. To me, the Jay-Z comeback album, after all, in my opinion, besides Blueprint, the comeback album from Jay-Z, his second comeback album. For me, you know, he kind of went back to his old roots with Reasonable Doubt. In a sense, as far as, like, not as far as production, but just as far as the drug talk, the street talk, and all that shit, you kind of got that with that album. It's a good album. It's not my favorite album from him, but I'm glad he went that route. You know, he's inspired by the movie, hence the name American Gangster, and stuff like that. And I know I'm missing Unfinished Business with R. Kelly, which was just like leftover tracks from R. Kelly. Then he had the Collision. Yeah, the Collision Course album with Linkin Park and stuff like that. Those were pretty cool. But American Gangster, like, yeah, songs like Rock Boys, Success with Nas, Ignorant Shit, I mean, Blue Magic, oh my god, like, that album got some shit. I mean, song playing in the background, you can't go wrong with that right there. And then 2 years later, he came out with Blueprint 3. Horrible album. Only had like three good songs I like from it. Which was, what was it? On to the Next One with Swiss Beats. That was pretty cool. Thank You. And I forgot the name of the first song. There was like the first two songs. Give me 1 second. I'm on Wikipedia, so gotta bear with me. What We Talking About, Thank You, and On to the Next One. Those are the songs that I like. But then you have the songs like Death of Autotune, Run This Town, which I couldn't stand. Those were like just couldn't really get into that. Overall, the whole album was just like all over the place for me. Didn't really care for that joint right there. Then in 2011, in the summer of 2011, him and Kanye came out with Watch the Throne. excuse me. That album was, it was okay. Kind of overrated again, you know what I mean? You had the song Otis, but then you had other songs like Church, No Church for the Thug, which was dope. I wish that was a single. But then you had songs like, I just have to go on Wikipedia. Then you had like Niggas in Paris. I couldn't stand that song. I hate that song. Murder to Excellence. That was okay. No Church in the Wild. Excuse me. That's what the song is called. I wish that was a video. I wish they had a single for that. I wish they had a video for that. But then you had songs like That's My Bitch. I didn't care for that. New Day was okay. Where he talks about his about his kid or Blue Ivy and stuff like that. But I don't know, the album was kind of over, it was overhyped, it was all over the place, didn't really care for that. But then he came with Magna Carta Holy Grail, which was like the last album that he put out in 2013. I thought that was a much better album compared to the other albums like Blueprint 3, Kingdom Come, you know. Yeah, it had a lot of filler tracks, but it definitely had some dope stuff. Like, it had like songs like Tom Ford, Oceans, Heaven, oh my god, shit like that, you know what I mean? It has some questionable tracks that I could have done without, but Nickels My Dime, Nickels and Dimes, I think is the name of the song. I forgot the name of the song, but yeah, I did a video on my thoughts on the Magna Carta Holy Grail. Definitely check that out when you guys get a chance. And that's pretty much it, man, as far as like Jay-Z, man. Overall, he's definitely one of the best MCs out right now. But I just think like he's gotten lazy over the years. I just think that, you know, he knows that people follow him like a god, and whatever he puts out, people's just gonna eat it like flies on shit. And that's not me. You know, and I'm not a dick about it. I'm a fan, but I'm an honest fan too. And I know it's gonna be a lot of haters like, oh, you a hater, you fat nigga, blah 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 blah, 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 blah. Like you work for the nigga or some shit, like you part of like Rock Nation or some shit like that. I'm just telling like it is. And you guys know I'm a big Mobb Deep fan, but I've mentioned some of the stuff that I didn't like about some of their albums. You know, I've mentioned the when they fell off, you know what I mean? So I feel like Jay-Z fell off, I hate to say it, but he did, but I do appreciate his work that he's done over the years, you know what I mean? But yeah, I'm eventually gonna have to do a review on his album, so like a full-length video, a full-length album review on the album, so definitely stay tuned for that, starting with Reasonable Doubt, then just working my way up and stuff like that, alright? Hope you guys enjoyed that review, or video, and hope to put out more, you know what I'm saying? Leave the comments, leave love and hate. If you're gonna hate, keep it respectful, tell me why you disagree with me. Don't be on some like fuck nigga shit. I'm not gonna bother, I'm not gonna respond to you. I'm just gonna delete you. I'm not gonna even respond to you or just delete you or ban you or spam you or whatever. I don't care, but just keep it respectful, all right? And that's pretty much it, folks. Peace.